This is Caden Prescorn.
This is JJ Pete Gies.
Hey everybody, this is Jackson Dart, Ole Miss quarterback. You're listening to the Red and Blue Crew with Dave and Brad.
Welcome to the Red and Blue Crew podcast, the source for all Ole Miss sports news, rumors, and innuendo. Are you ready? From the Inside the Rebels studios, let's get ready to rumble. Now here are your hosts, David Johnson and Brad Logan.
And welcome in the Red Blue Crew podcast. Brad Logan alongside David Johnson in a very cold and a very icy North Mississippi. For folks that are listening down around Jackson, Meridian, Biloxi, you guys have it made. We're absolutely, you know, stuck to our house. And luckily for David and I, we can work from home. But a lot of other people that have to be out and about, they haven't been able to move their vehicle, let alone go to work. So it's been very difficult here in North Mississippi, David. I know Oxford is just slick right now as we record on Thursday afternoon.
Let me tell you this. About 30 minutes ago, I decided to try to go to the store. And my house is about a quarter mile off the main road. But when you get to the main road, there's a convenience store just like, 100 yards. So not a big trip. I live in a very woodsy, hilly neighborhood. And I couldn't make it up the small hill to get to the main road. So we slid backwards, and then I just put it in reverse and turned around and came back to the house. It is slick out there, very slick. And I got up this morning, and I was doing my morning walk. And, you know, by the time I got back to the house, I almost fell about a dozen times. And I was like, man, it wasn't this slick yesterday.
Yeah.
And that translates to the roads as well. I know OPD has shut down some of the thoroughfares in Oxford. They're serious. Do not go out unless you absolutely have to. I admit I didn't have to. Little stir crazy, little bit of everything. And I just decided I wanted to. And bad decision. So stay put.
I live about 30 minutes south of you, and it's even more woodsier and even more remote than where you live. And so it is, you know, the place where I live is not equipped for this weather. And it actually rained this morning, which made everything just completely glazed over. So yeah, it is a nightmare.
Yeah, here in Oxford, there's been a freezing rain mist that's kind of been laying on top of everything. And, you know, it's bad. I was out walking yesterday, and the young lady who lives across the street from me, she has a 1-year-old, and she's got him in the stroller walking down the road, and bless her heart, she falls. And, thankfully she was okay, but, it's just dangerous. It's very dangerous out there. A friend of my wife's, her husband went to Kroger earlier this morning, and they live probably a mile down the road from us. So it's a little bit further. And he was telling his wife how people were just falling flat on their butt in the Kroger parking lot.
Yeah.
So that translates to even more danger if you're behind a vehicle. Stay home. And fortunately, we've had lights, we've had internet. No outages at all. Big shout out to AT&T for that. I changed internet service providers back before the fall began, and I'm so happy I did.
Yeah, we've been good here too. It's just been, you hate to say the C word, but it feels like it's that again. You know, you can't go anywhere. You're kind of locked down to your house. And
what is that C word, Brad? What are you talking about?
I hate to say it, but it's COVID. It feels like.
Yeah, okay.
Kind of like COVID, but yeah, everything's kind of confided to our houses and that sort of thing. But that doesn't mean that recruiting and men's basketball, women's basketball is not rock solid.
One other point before we get into the meat of this podcast.
Yeah.
You know, you say it was like COVID. Honestly, I have no recollection of any of that.
I know you have a different road than
out of it. And you know, when I woke up, it was kind of over. And the family was like telling me all these things of, Yeah, we couldn't go out. We couldn't go eat. We couldn't go to Walmart. If you went to Walmart, they were only letting like 20 people in at a time. So you had to stand in line to go in. You had to have a mask everywhere. Now, I remember the tail end of the masking crap. But, yeah, the all the juicy COVID stuff, I was unconscious. I missed all that.
Well, you know, Evie Van Pelt, who does a great job with the Rebel Walk, she and I had a conversation over in Atlanta there in the Peach Bowl. We were talking about so many things. And, of course, your name got brought up. And then she said, you know, I can't look at David and not be grateful that he's still here. You know, she and I chatted with your daughter and your wife while you were out, and you never knew it. But she and I we would exchange information. And, you know, Dave, you're one of the people that are here with us that we didn't know that we were going to be here. And I know everybody listening to this show can remember someone either in their family or friend circle that either they lost or that they were really worried about. And so, you know, it kind of brings back a lot of memories for a lot of us.
Yeah. And, you know, it was so weird when I did finally make it home. And look, we were not intending on talking about any of this, but we are. So, you know, I look back at Twitter and Facebook and social media accounts and, you know, all of you who are praying for me, I just, you know, still, it's been 3.5 years and I can't thank you enough. You know, and I ultimately believe that's what brought me out of the hospital. Was everybody turning to God and asking him to. But, you know, I go to the mailbox and I'm pulling out letters from people like Joe Moorhead, from people like John Smoltz, who, you know, had heard of everything and, you know, just wanted to wish me well. I've got a great photograph of John Smoltz being inducted into the Hall of Fame that he included with his letter, with a great inscription, autographed. That just blew me away, Brad. It really blew me away. You know, and Joe Moorhead had been fired up at Mississippi State and was already at Oregon. And, you know, he was keeping up with everything from all the way up there, something I greatly appreciate. Steve Campbell, my close friend, who's on the Mississippi State staff now. Can't say enough about the Ole Miss coaches. You know, and what they did, all the Delta State coaches that I covered in my youth, which is quickly passing me by. You know, I'm 52 and a grandfather now, and I don't know if I'm mentally ready for that. Grateful to have a grandson, Troy Christian Johnson, 8.5 pounds, 21 inches long, and hopefully is going to growing to be a giant, because I know his daddy will have him on the football field before long.
And people ask me, man, you know, you guys talk about it and everything's kind of laid out perfectly. And you talk about recruiting, you go from the, how long does it take to put that show together? And I said, oh, I don't know, about 10, 15 seconds.
Yeah.
We don't have a script. We have kind of topics that we want to hit, and we pretty much play off each other pretty well. So it's not a big, I hate to take you behind the curtain and say that we have long production meetings, but, no, we don't. They come across very quick. But David, let's shift gears just for a moment. Let's talk about Ole Miss Athletics. And, if you followed along and you saw the piece by Pat Forty, and if you have not seen it, you could just go to si.com, and I'm sure it's front and center on college sports, but, he just absolutely takes Ross Bjork down to the cleaners, washes him, rinses him, takes him outside, and runs over him with a truck. He absolutely eviscerates Ross Bjork. And
you hear that? That's applause. That's applause for 40.
It was so bad, David. I wonder, you know, you remember when Pat Forty was coming after Ole Miss during the investigation?
Sure.
I now think that it wasn't so much he had so much of a problem with Ole Miss. I think he's got a major problem with Ross Bjork, judging by the article.
Yeah, he's not on Bjork's Christmas card list anymore, if he ever was. But, you know, what basically – and it's linked to the Inside the Rebels message board if you haven't read it, but – basically, he said, you know, a firm handshake and a square jawline will get you far in America. And that's all Ross has. That's it. And he highlighted his failures at A&M and his failures at Ole Miss. And, you know, it makes you think, what in the hell is Ohio State thinking? They basically could have almost had any AD in America they wanted. And they hired this guy who, I'm going to tell you, he sold Hugh Freeze out to save his own butt, period. And I don't know anything for a fact, but I'll say this, Brad. If you think for 1 second Hugh Freeze's teams of lawyers and Ole Miss's teams of lawyers accidentally left phone numbers in Hugh's log when Hugh had to turn those numbers in to a party that had subpoenaed them, they accidentally left them. Bullcrap. And there's not, to me, not but one person ever that could have stuck a phone number or two back in there for those to be found. Now, right, wrong, indifferent, I don't care what you think about it, but I truly believe that happened. And maybe I'm being too controversial, but I think that happened so Ross could get a clean bill of health, could get the Texas A&M job, which he's turned into the Ohio State job, which, you know, once he fails up there and they're not going to put up with it in Columbus, you know, he'll be back at Florida International or Arkansas State or somewhere else. So I agree with everything Forty wrote. I think he was right.
Looking at Bjork getting the job, and it came out and happened pretty quick, Ohio State is the, if not the preeminent, the number one program in the country in regards to athletic departments. I think they have 41 sports, male and female. How do they do any due diligence at all? I mean, how does this happen? Does he just interview really well?
I think he does. I mean, you've been in a room with Ross before. He's an impressive human
being. He is.
But, you know, you start digging past the surface and, you know, you kind of go, wow, this guy's a real crap head. At least that was many people in my profession's opinion of him. And, you know, the NCAA stuff with Ole Miss was handled wrong all the way around. And, you know, he didn't have any balls, pardon the French there, to stand up to them. And it cost Ole Miss dearly. And I think that's sad. I think it's really, really, really sad. Really sad. There's Ross calling me on my cell phone.
Looking at Ole Miss now, past Ross Bjork, and now that we've learned that Keith Carter is the athletic director, what are your thoughts on Ole Miss after Ross leaves Ole Miss and goes off to Texas A&M?
Brad, will you ask me that one more time?
Yeah, just kind of looking at this thing 10,000 feet. You know, the article about Ross, it's a lot of stuff being drudged up. Back when Hugh Freeze was the head coach, obviously there's been a lot of water pass since then, Matt Luke, now Lane Kiffin. What are your overall thoughts when Ross leaves the athletic department? And I don't think it's fair to get into all of the people under Ross's tutelage who is no longer here, who also were complicit in all of this, turning over documents, that sort of thing. We won't get into that, but a lot of those folks have moved on. Where is Ole Miss now after Ross leaving versus when Ross was here? Look, playing a little devil's advocate before you answer that question, I think what Ole Miss did while Ross was here, I think there were a lot of good things. There were a lot of good things facility-wise, financial-wise, bringing former players back. I think there were a lot of good things, but I do think it's important to look at the overall, you know, 10,000 feet view, and I was going to ask you that.
Yeah, first of all, I don't give him the credit that others do in terms of building facilities, because that was Ole Miss boosters' money that made that happen. It wasn't Ross Bjork. Now, He may have marshaled everybody together, but it was Ole Miss money. But how I would answer that question is with a question. Can you find me one Ole Miss fan that would say, yes, I would trade Keith Carter to get Ross Bjork back?
Well, once again, playing a little devil's advocate, Keith Carter may go down in history as one of, well, he will go down in history as one of the best. I don't know. He may go down in history at the end of his regime at Ole Miss as the best athletic director. So that's really kind of unfair to Ross to say that. I don't think anybody would take Ross over Keith Carter, but I do think people would take Ross over maybe some other former athletic directors. That was my point. At the time, I thought Ross was pretty good, in my opinion, about how he was able to navigate the big money donors, how he circumvented the Ole Miss Athletic Foundation, how Keith Carter started the Ole Miss, or not started it, but when he came in under Ross and turned over the UMA Foundation, which would eventually turn into Ole Miss Athletic Foundation, which now Denson Hollis is doing a great job. But he had a rogue pay from him from Keith Carter, and Keith was put in that position by Ross Bjork.
Well, you know, the thing that hadn't been said about Keith is, you know, first of all, he has done an incredible job, an absolutely incredible job. The thing Keith cast aside, just a 10,000-foot view here, if you will, are all of the old stereotypes and prejudices and things of that nature that previous Ole Miss athletic directors had. I mean, you know, wear the uniform the recruits like. He doesn't care. He's not going to make you go out there in the traditional red uniform or the traditional Navy jersey. And, you know, live in the 21st century. And that's what Keith's done. He's made some bold, bodacious hires. One being Lane Kiffin. Two being Chris Beard. You know, the only good hire, and I got a feeling that he wasn't as heavily involved in this as he likes to take credit for, was, you know, you let McPhee McEwen under Ross. And, you know, he put Matt Luke in as interim head coach. Keith had to rectify that problem. And that was something that Forty pointed out in the story. He hired Kermit Davis. Keith had to fix that problem. So, you know, I look at those things more as Ross's legacy at Ole Miss versus, you know, the fact we built the pavilion. You had to build the pavilion. It was long overdue. And I got to be honest with you, the expansion of Vaught-Hemingway Stadium, the end zone expansion, I think really turned that end of the field into a cavernous no man's land at points. And the points being when only maybe the student section is 50% charged. We didn't have that issue this past season, but we've looked down there before and went, my gosh, look at all of those empty aluminum bleachers in this bowled in area of the stadium. And, you know, but again, Ole Miss money and the willingness of the Ole Miss fan base to donate to those causes built the pavilion and expanded Vaught-Hemingway.
I think a lot of Ole Miss fans, sure, I think there's an argument to be made about everything that you just said, but most Ole Miss fans look back at the investigation and rightly or wrongly how it was handled, and they just do not support how Ross Bjork and his team, legal team, university legal team, handle that. And that will forever go down along with the scapegoat. And this is a word that doesn't like to be thrown around a lot, but Hugh Freeze was a bit of a scapegoat, and he created a lot of that on his own. He did. He created a lot of his problems. But at the end of the day, Ross Bjork came after Hugh.
Yeah.
And Hugh was a scapegoat, and Ross rode off to Texas A&M. Yeah, I'm not saying that it was right or wrong how he handled the investigation. I'm just saying a lot of Ole Miss fans do not believe that Ross handled that investigation properly.
Well, I think he handled it properly for his own career self-advancement. And I think that was always in the back of his mind. And, you know, going back to alluding back to a comment I made earlier in this podcast, I think he handed Hugh Freeze to the NCAA on a silver platter. I truly do. And, you know, I've probably said enough, all I need to say about that. But there you have it. Well, Ross Buell, Ohio State AD.
Yep, and Ole Miss fans, you know, most people that went through all that, and you and I went through it, you know, very deeply, or we watched it all unfold. We're all waiting to hear what Ross Buell has to say, because he said he could not wait to tell his side of the story. And that's kind of become a punchline, but, you know, throughout the years. But David, he never told Ole Miss's side of the story, and now he's on his second stop since Ole Miss.
And in fairness to Ross, he was already at A&M really before he really got the chance to tell his side of the story. Maybe he'll write a book one day, but
I don't think he ever had any intention whatsoever of telling the Ole Miss side of the story. So,
and I hate to tell you, Brad, but you and I both are not on Ross Bjork's Christmas card list anymore. We're going to be off as well.
Well, you know, I've never had an issue with Ross. I'm not sure he ever, you know, really cared for me a lot, and that's okay. He was always very respectful to me, very nice to me. So I don't have a problem with Ross. I do think it's important to bring out to light what happened under different leadership, you know, positions throughout Ole Miss history, and this particular one came up because Pat Forty wrote an article, and it was very scathing, and I think it's important to note what happened at Ole Miss during that time. That's why we're talking about it here today. We want to turn the page just a little bit over to recruiting, David, and it has continued to rock along. There have been some bumps in the road over the last couple of weeks. Ole Miss missing out on some of the bigger prospects as they've committed to other places. Kendrick Breedlove, the linebacker, commits to Alabama. Ole Miss misses out on him. But there are some other options. Ole Miss did get a commitment yesterday from cornerback Marion Walker, the 6'3", 180 defensive back out of Ponchatoula, Louisiana, transfers in from Michigan. There's also a couple of players that we'll be looking at. That's B.J. Green, defensive lineman out of Powder Springs, Georgia. He's at Arizona State. And then another player, David, that you've actually crystal balled, that's Trey Amos, the cornerback out of New Iberia, Louisiana, out of Catholic High School, transfer out of Alabama. What's the latest that you're hearing on the ground in regards to Ole Miss recruiting and the portal?
Yeah, first of all, let's talk a little bit about Walker. You know, people look at his stat line and they go, well, he didn't play a lot for the national champions this year. This guy is a freak athlete. He's done some crazy stuff with the three-cone drill, with all of these drills the coaches put these guys through. I mean, he's turning NFL-type numbers. I think he had the seventh most snaps among Michigan quarterbacks, cornerbacks this year. That's okay because you have a freakish-type athlete coming in who is going to get coached up by Pete Golding and his underlings. And, you know, you already know the athletic potential is there. Big time get from the University of Michigan. Now, excuse me. Now, with Trey Amos, he's going to be here this weekend. And I don't think it's going to take long before he climbs into the fold. Ole Miss desperately wants him. I said this a week ago, Brad, the portal's not slowing down for Ole Miss and not going to slow down for Ole Miss. And you alluded to the guys who have, and I'll put this in quote marks, flipped to Michigan. Nicholson, it was a great issue. He couldn't get into school here. And he could get into Louisville. Now, and you know, I don't know what that means, but that's exactly what we were told that happened. Barron, I simply think the NIL got to an area that we were no longer comfortable with. not with everybody else that we have coming in. So, you know, I think they're going to continue working hard in the transfer portal. And as a matter of fact, I know they are. And one other thing I want to talk about recruiting, I don't know if you've noticed, but man, there have been a whole lot of offers sent out over in the state of Alabama to high school guys. And, you know, you might go, well, that's not unusual. It's early in the year. You know, Ole Miss is going to stick their finger in there and see what is blowing their way. But these are highly rated prospects Ole Miss is offering. And I have a theory, and it's called because the Nick Saban is gone theory, that recruiting against Alabama in Alabama will not be the same animal it has been when you've got an opportunity to go play for the greatest college football coach of all time. And I think Ole Miss is hedging their bets that Caleb DeBoer is not going to do as good of a job as Alabama hopes he will, and that they're going to be able to start pulling some of this high school talent, highly rated high school talent, out of the state of Alabama. And as far as the transfer portal goes, we know Alabama's in the middle of a 30-day window where players can enter the portal, and because Saban left. And we know they're working that angle extremely hard. And I put a note up a couple of days ago. I was talking to a source down in Columbia, Mississippi, the hometown of Jaheim Otis. And he seems to think that Otis is going to show up in the portal here very soon. Now, if you remember right, Ole Miss was a dark horse candidate to get Otis when he committed to Alabama a couple of years ago. So, you know, does that have any bearing on Tyler Barron leaving? Probably not, but, you know, Barron was an edge and Otis is going to play on the interior, but it could have some possibility that when you weigh the whole roster out, you feel like you're in good shape and you're not going to pay any more money for Tyler Barron. So, you know, that doesn't bother me that badly.
How severe is Alabama going to feel the transfer portal push even more than they're feeling now? I think I read, what, David, 13 people have entered the portal? 13 players? I'm not sure if it's that many or is it more? It just seems like there's been a lot come across the last couple of days.
Yeah, I think the number I saw was in the 20s.
Okay, could be.
Since the middle of December. And, you know, the bottom line is until DeBoer wins at Alabama, I just don't think he carries that much weight recruiting Southern football talent. I mean, it was great he did that at Washington, but I'll tell you this. I think Washington was an 8-4 team if they played an SEC schedule. And if he goes 8-4 or worse at Alabama in 2024, he's going to be on the hot seat. And, Brad, I got to tell you, I don't see any way Alabama avoids going at least 9-3. In his first year as head coach.
Ole Miss, we're not going to be able to get to basketball today. We got too caught up on so many other things. We'll get to that in a couple of days. We promise you we will come back and talk more Ole Miss basketball. They lose, of course, the other night to LSU, but there are a lot of positives in that 89-80 loss that Ole Miss. I mean, free throw shooting was great, and I thought they shot really well. They got it down to 6, David, there at the end of the game. And I didn't like the Flanagan 3. I thought that was a play of the game with about a minute 17 to go. Flanagan shoots the 3, doesn't go in. LSU comes down and makes a couple of free throws, and the ball game's over. I say, let's go ahead and talk about it for a minute. I thought they played really well, and Chris Beard was very complimentary of LSU. I thought LSU played well. Also, Ole Miss just couldn't get it down the road. I really felt like if they could go 1-1 between LSU and Auburn, come home against Arkansas, they would have things in the right direction. But the good news for Ole Miss fans, at least they did play pretty well.
You know, And you know who this is. Lloyd Clark once told me, some nights you can't spit in a swinging bucket, and some nights you hit it every time you try. And he didn't say spit.
Okay? No, he did not. Our good friend from Vicksburg did not say spit.
But I'll say this much. LSU just shot the lights out from beyond the arc last night. And you're right, Ole Miss shot very good free throws all night long. But, you know, I think the verdict is still out right now. There's no doubt this team is better, playing a better brand of basketball than we've seen here in years. And I do think the sky is the ceiling for these guys as they continue to get better and get more chemistry. But the bottom line is you've played four SEC games and you're 2-2. Now, does that translate to going, what do we play, 18 league games, 9-9? If it does, it's a tournament team.
It is.
Maybe not quite as high of a seed as number five, as somebody from CBS said earlier this week, before the loss last night. But the SEC has got a lot of parity in it this year. And I'll say this, it would not surprise me that much if Ole Miss beat Auburn Saturday night. Now, I'm not saying that's going to happen. By all pieces of paper, they should lose that game and be 2-3 in the SEC. But it wouldn't surprise me if a focused and hot Ole Miss team won that game. And you know, part of the reason is it's Chris Beard. Man, he doesn't get too upset.
I was just about to say the same thing.
Yelling and screaming. I mean, you see Beard sitting in the seat between his two assistant coaches all night, and he's strategizing, thinking, and he's really thinking ahead. And, you know, that makes me feel good about the chances for a special season moving ahead. But, again, the SEC, almost anybody can beat anybody on any given night. And I know that's an overused cliche in the SEC, but man, it's true with men's basketball this year.
And the good news for Ole Miss, once again, they play really well. And I've said all along, win your home games. Find you a couple on the road that you can win. I thought that one the other night was one they could win. They didn't. That's just good. Put a little bit more pressure on to finding another one or two down the road that you can win. And once again, the good news, Ole Miss played really well and could not come away with the win down the stretch. I would have loved to have seen G.T. Murray take that three instead of instead of Flanagan there with 117. But you know what? He didn't. And Ole Miss falls. David, real quick, we've got right at 1 minute before we have to go. The women's program has Georgia on the road. They really need a win.
Yeah, they do. And this is a pretty good Georgia team. It's almost like the men. Anybody can beat anybody on the women's side. I don't think Madison Scott should continue playing the point. And I've said that. I've wrote about it. And I'm not criticizing anybody. I mean, Coach O knows more about coaching basketball than I could ever learn. But I just don't think it looks right. It doesn't feel right. They're out of rhythm. And then you miss Madison Scott's production under the basket. But that's just me, your old friendly sports writer, with his take. Coach O knows more about it than I do.
He's David Johnson. I'm Brad Logan. We'll talk to you soon right here on the Red and Blue Crew Podcast. Stay warm, everybody. We'll have plenty of wall-to-wall coverage on the Red and Blue Crew Podcast, also on reps247.com, all sponsored, of course, by our good friends at the College Corner Store.
I'm out of here, bud.
College Corner is headed to Oxford. Stop by their new location in the Oxford Commons off Sisk Avenue. They'll have 4,000 square feet of Rebel gear ready for your trip to the Grove. On your next trip to Oxford, stop by the College Corner or our other great locations in Ridgeland and Flowood. Hats, shirts, polos, pullovers, sweats, t-shirts. College Corner has it all. And as always, you can visit us online at collegecornerstore.com. That's collegecornerstore.com. The College Corner, where your game day apparel meets.
It is a place which exerts an extraordinary pull on all who have walked its hallowed ground. Thousands come each year, and yet no one ever really leaves. Ole Miss is for life, a major university with the familiar intimacy of family. Friendships that are more than friendships, moments that are more than moments. An autumn celebration on a Saturday afternoon in the Grove. Contests waged and triumphs savored. With our largest freshman class, soaring honors college, national reputation for academics and research, our pride is overflowing. Today, more than ever, for all who have ever called this magical place home, you never leave Ole Miss.
You've been listening to the Red and Blue Crew podcast with your hosts, David Johnson and Brad Logan, the source for all Ole Miss sports news, rumors, and innuendo. From the Inside the Rebels studios, join us next time right here on the Red and Blue Crew podcast.